Gupta, chairman, and friends, what is meditation? Historians say, even as far back as in the Mohenjo-daro civilization, there is evidence that meditation was a common practice among the people of India. In fact, an image has been, a statue has been found where you see a yogi meditating. So this meditation has been known to us since the very beginning of our civilization. Our people have practiced meditation. Now the question is, do we meditate according to a common code of meditation, according to a common and accepted code, or each individual decides how he or she will meditate? Each individual has his or her own way of meditation. Although you find books where you have instructions given as to how you should meditate, but you find that the instructions are not very clear to you. In fact, you may even find that the instructions are beyond you do not understand them, or you do not know what exactly is expected of you according to these instructions. Now, this is something very, very subjective. It's personal. You think in your own way. Maybe you have a good textbook on meditation. It's a book written by somebody known to be a good yogi, a highly advanced, spiritually advanced person. You have his instructions. You say, well, here are the instructions. But when you try to practice them, you find that the instructions are not enough. You need some guidance, personal guidance, somebody who has practiced those instructions, who has applied those instructions in his own life, has achieved some results, and is ready to help you in your practice of meditation. The word meditate means to think. You think. Now the question is what? Think of what? It's a question of directing. Our mind is never empty. Our mind is always occupied with something or other. Often it is occupied with things which are absolutely stupid, which are perhaps even detrimental to ourselves. When we talk of meditation, we mean thinking where I am in control of the mind. It's not that I allow the mind to think the way it likes. I try to direct the mind to some object or some idea or something or other. And I try to fix the mind on that object. In fact, the mind is always restless, as the Gita says. It's like the wind, as you cannot control the wind. Similarly, you cannot control the mind, your own mind. And if you are not able to control your mind, there is really no meditation. Meditation means thinking of things which you like, which you think are good for you, things pleasant, things beneficial to ourselves. It's a question of directing your mind towards some goal, some ideal. It may be some form of God, some concept, something abstract perhaps. You find that sometimes the instructions that are given in books on meditation, you are told to think that there is some light within, there is something luminous within. It may be a figure, or it may be just when it may be Om, and Om is luminous in your heart, or you have a figure, you have a favorite deity, and you have that deity within yourself, and you are trying to fix your mind on that figure. Now, what is the idea behind this kind of directing the mind onto some particular figure or some particular concept or some particular idea? The reason is, in India we believe that we think, and if we think deeply and constantly, we are then transformed into what we are thinking of. Again and again you find in the Hindu scriptures, it is, you are the architect of your fate. You are what you think you are. If you think you are good, then you become good too. So think of things that you like, that you think will be good for you. You concentrate your mind on some ideas, but ideas are abstract. Better for us, perhaps easier for us, to think of some form, some figure, and you keep thinking of that figure all the time. You fix your mind on that figure, and they say you concentrate your mind on that figure like you are pouring oil from one pot to another pot in a continuous stream. There is no break. Similarly, your mind is fixed on that figure, like say a bee sitting on a flower. You are the bee, your mind is the bee, and your mind is fixed on the flower. the ideal, the figure that you have chosen for yourself, and you keep thinking of that figure all the time, all the time. It's true that you find in the scriptures that you have to sit in a particular posture, you choose a good place, a quiet place. As Sri Ramakrishna says, when you meditate, try to meditate in a corner of your house so that there are not too many people around, you alone, you and with your own ideal, your God, your deity. You sit down and meditate, or you meditate inside the curtain, mosquito curtain, he says. The place is not very, very important. You would like to have a quiet place, but it may be that you have a kind of environment where it is difficult for you to have a quiet place. But if you have a quiet place, in fact, it is expected that you withdraw your mind entirely from things around. Maybe there are people talking, but you don't hear. Because if your mind is occupied with something within, people might be talking about you, but you do not hear what they are saying about you. It is possible that by practice you withdraw your outgoing organs. All of our organs are outgoing. The organs that we have in the body are outgoing. But there are moments when you are not even aware of where you are. You are, when we say, when we are absent-minded, that is to say when our mind is on a higher plane or some other plane, or when our mind is occupied with something, it may be some problem, and you are totally occupied with that object, that problem, and it may be somebody is calling you and you don't hear, or somebody is before you and he is talking to you, trying to draw your attention, but you do not hear. You are absolutely indrawn. This is what is called contemplation. You are indrawn. You are inside. Inside there is a world which is much more real than the world that we see with our eyes, the world that we perceive through our sense organs. A real yogi lives in a world of his own. He is within himself. He is not conscious of what is going on around him. It is this kind of withdrawal from the world outside which is called yoga. That is to say, you are in communion with your own self within. You are in communion with your own self within, and the world outside ceases to exist so far as you are concerned. So this is this kind of concentration of the mind. When we talk of meditation, it means thinking of some object, of something that I am fond of, something which I think will be good for me, thinking deeply, constantly, Like as I said, you are pouring oil from one pot to another pot in a unbroken jet stream. It's like that. You are pouring yourself into something that you love, something which you think is good for you, maybe a form of God, if you are a religious person. If you are not a religious person, how do you meditate, or how do you meditate on? If you are not a religious person, you certainly are a person who would like to see himself transformed in terms of character. I am good, Paras, but I can be better, and I'd like to be better. I'd like to be pure in all respects. Leave alone religion. Of course, it helps if you are religious, and then you have the direction, you know the direction that you should follow. But if you are not religious, let us say you just want to be a morally perfect person, you want to be perfect, you want to attain perfection in terms of character, think of yourself as a perfect person. You are within, you are perfect, always perfect. And if you keep thinking all the time that you are perfect, you are good, you are pure, you are honest, you are transformed, you become honest. You can never do anything wrong, difficult for you. It hurts you when you find that you are thinking of something which is not good, which is not clean, not pure. So, meditation. Why should you meditate? Why? Because somehow or other we feel, I am not happy, I am not satisfied. All of us have that feeling. We are not happy. Why we are not happy, we do not know. Maybe we have problems, but of course, life has problems. Cannot imagine a life where there are no problems. You may be a very successful person. You may be a rich man, maybe a powerful man, but you have problems. And you know, there is a wonderful statement in the scripture which says, how can I go beyond fear? I have a fear haunting me all the time. I'm rich. That doesn't mean that I have no problems. It doesn't mean that I have no worry. I am rich, I have money, but I still worry. I worry lest my money is grabbed by somebody else. People around, my own relatives, may cheat me. They may take my money away, or I put the money, I have invested the money somewhere, and somewhere or other things go wrong, and the money that I put in investment is lost. This may happen. The loss of money, loss of health, loss of beauty, loss of youth, loss of the position which now I occupy in society. This loss, and in fact, whatever I possess today is perishable. It will not be there after a period of time. I lose my health, I lose the reputation that I have, and so on. So the idea, the fear of loss, that is why the Hindu scripture says, some or other we have to go beyond fear, abhayam. That is what is called liberation. We have to attain a state where I am free from fear. I am not afraid of anything. So I have problems and I keep worrying. A rich man has his own problems. A scholar has his own problems. A political leader has his own problems. Each individual has his own problems. So we worry. And we are unhappy. We do not, they say, there are people who do not have good sleep at night. They take sleeping pills. Still they do not sleep. They do not have sound sleep. They are disturbed in mind. While a rich man spends a sleepless night, a poor man, a beggar, the man who is living on the pavement. I sometimes used to go round for a walk. I used to go to the lakes nearby. I don't go nowadays. And I often noticed that on the pavement there were beggars. They might be beggars, they might not be beggars. Maybe they by choice, they are sleeping on the pavement with a brick as the pillow on the pavement, or no brick even, just maybe it is some piece of cloth. They unroll the cloth and they lie on it and they enjoy sound sleep. Not like the rich people who have money and yet who do not have good sleep. So worry, some or other. You see, we say we are advancing. I admit we are advancing. We are advancing many, many directions. Nevertheless, we have problems and we worry all the time, worrying. In whatever position you may be, you are a successful businessman, you are a big industrialist, you are doing very well, you have money, and you have a good reputation, you are highly respected. But that doesn't mean that you have no worry. The more you advance, the more life becomes complicated, and the more worries trouble your mind all the time. Now, what can meditation do about this? They say, you practice meditation, turn your mind away from things outside, direct your mind inside, and keep thinking of yourself as a perfect man, as a good man, an honest man. You, each individual has his own concept of what is called perfection. So keep thinking of perfection, of purity, of goodness, of beauty, honesty, moral perfection. You are not a religious person, but surely you will admit that you have to be a good moral person. So your moral perfection, think of your moral life and you try to fix your mind on a certain level where you are satisfied with yourself. Your satisfaction, not what other people think about you. Other people may think you are a perfect man already, but you know yourself. If you are a perfect man, you will always go on finding fault with yourself. You will say, no, I am not perfect. I am not as perfect as I'd like to be. I go on finding fault with myself. But meditation, if I keep meditating on myself, I imagine I am at a level when I am perfect. I love people. I love everybody. I have no enemy. I do not bear ill will towards anybody. Goodwill, friendship, and a sense of unity, a sense of oneness. If I hurt you, I hurt myself. So I will never hurt you. This sense of oneness, sense of feeling that I have to care for everybody. I can't afford to be selfish. A selfish man is never happy. And I am not going to be a selfish man. I will be an unselfish man. I will think more of others than of myself. I love people. I will serve them. I will be happy if I am of some service to others. This sort of life. Because you are not religious. If you are religious, then of course things are easier. If you are religious, you have some ideal. Let us say you think of Buddha. You imagine that you are Buddha all the time. You have that figure within yourself. And the thinking of Buddha, according to the Hindu scriptures, will transform you into a Buddha. You become a Buddha. You are what you think you are, again and again. This is repeated in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. He used to say, if you think you are a sinner, you will become a sinner. But if you think you are pure, you are good, you are honest, you are beautiful, you are what you think you are. So if you think of Buddha, Buddha is your ideal, and you think of Buddha, and look at the face of Buddha. Look at the face, calm, peaceful. There is an aura of happiness, of joy, of purity around him. And in fact, in our country, people who practice meditation, their mind is at rest. The trouble is with the mind. The mind is always restless, running about. Oh, we have to practice what Sri Ramakrishna used to do. Whenever he dealt with his mind, he would say, look, mind, stay here. Don't run about. I won't let you do that. Stay here, stay at rest, stay here at the feet of Mother. So if you are religious, the problem is easier to solve. Otherwise, you do not know what you are going to fix your mind on. Some abstract thought, some principle, some idea. Swami Vivekananda says you can fix your mind on some idea. But something abstract keeps all the time eluding you. You'd like to have something concrete, something tangible, something real. So you choose. Let us say you choose Buddha as your ideal, or Christ as your ideal, or somebody else, and you keep thinking, and you are happy and peace. It is all to say, the scriptures say, all within your power, practice. You cannot achieve it immediately, no? It takes time, and you have to keep practicing. You practice, and slowly you find you are able to control your mind. As of now, the mind is restless, always running about from one thing to another, wasting time. But if you keep practicing, you imagine, you look within yourself, you don't look outside. Your eyes, your ears, your sense organs, organs of perception, restrict their area of operation. Slowly, the world ceases to exist, so far as you are concerned. You are within yourself. inside. Inside, there is a much bigger world than the world that you see outside. You are within that world, and you have your chosen ideal, and you are in constant contact with that ideal. You are always thinking of that ideal, or you are thinking of your hero. It may be Buddha, or it may be some or other. It is now recognized all over the world that the trouble is with our mind. We have to control the mind. Control the mind, some or other. And meditation is the only way by which we can control our mind. You meditate. Meditate means you fix your mind on something, some principle, some ideal, something which attracts you, which appeals to you, which you think is very good, is inspiring. So fix your mind on that is your own being. Your own being. When you think of Buddha and keep thinking of Buddha, it means that you are going to be Buddha. You are one with Buddha. Slowly, as you keep thinking, to begin with, you and Buddha are separate. But as you keep thinking of Buddha, you become one with Buddha. You forget yourself. You think of Buddha only. You think you are Buddha. And slowly, you begin to develop within yourself the qualities which characterized Buddha, and you become Buddha, and peace and happiness and a sense of fulfillment. Look at the face of Buddha. I've attained Bodhi. I've attained my goal. I know I am perfect. So this sort of practice, meditation, not easy, takes time. But if it has been possible for one, as Swami Vivekananda used to say, if there has been one Buddha in the world, there can be more Buddhas in the world. Each one of us, why not? Why not? Look around. You sometimes meet people in your neighborhood, very humble, but honest, good, always trying to go out of his way to help others. Such people, why should I not be like that? It is a matter of being and becoming. I am not satisfied with myself. There is that expression, divine discontent. In all of us, there is discontent. And this discontent is a divine gift. Because there is this discontent, because I am not satisfied with myself, I am not going to judge myself by the certificate which I receive from my friends. No, I judge myself. I look critically at myself and I say, well, I still have many loopholes, I have many weaknesses. I must get rid of them. I must be perfect, perfect by my own standard. I want peace of mind, happiness. Look around, and there are people, they may be poor, they may not be very rich and not very learned, but cheerful, happy, smiling, good, always trying to help other people. Only such qualities can give us a sense of fulfillment. If I feel for others, if I love others, if I am ready to sacrifice my own interests for the sake of others, I'll be a happy man. The more I think of myself, the more I think of my own well-being, I will be unhappy. Today the problem is, how can we be happy? The less we think of ourselves, the more will be the possibility of our being happy. We can be happy if you are unselfish. Today, we think that happiness depends upon money. Happiness depends upon scholarship. Happiness depends upon my position in society. All this is wrong. Happiness depends upon what sort of person I am. According to my own judgment, I am not going to attach any importance to what other people think about me. They may think I am bad, but I know I am not bad, that bad at least, that they think I am. But I want to be a person, an individual. It is a matter, as somebody said, you start with a chunk of stone and you are a sculptor. You begin with a certain piece of stone, and you have your hammer and you start working on that stone, and you are working there alone. People around do not know what you are doing, but they know you are inside and you are doing something. You are busy, you never allow people to come and interfere with your work. You are working alone, and after a while you have an exhibition, and that is to the amazement of everybody, that is a beautiful statue of Buddha, a perfect. It is like that. I am the architect of my own fate. I have to. The very concept of meditation arises from the fact that you recognize that you are responsible for what you are today or what you are going to be tomorrow. It's all up to you. You have to decide what you are going to be. You have to have an idea of your own. Perfect. You are Mr. X, and you are going to be a perfect Mr. X. Perfect in terms of your character, your personality, your outlook on life. You are not a selfish person. You are a person who feels for others, cares for others, ready to share the suffering and hardship of others. That sort of person is happiness, is happy. A selfish man can never be happy. Swami Vivekananda used to say, a selfish man is immoral. I don't know why he said immoral. That is to say, it was selfish. You would not bother about morality. You will say, well, I need money and I will have money by all means. By hook or by crook, I will have some money. Like this, a selfish man is very likely to be immoral. But a selfish man can never be happy. He thinks his family exists for his own sake. He's never for his own sake. The whole world exists for his own sake. He thinks of himself only, and he is never happy. So, meditation on an ideal. Yourself as an ideal. You choose the ideal and try to think that you are that ideal. You are already that ideal. And concentrate on that ideal. And slowly you begin to change. You realize you are improving, and that encourages you, and slowly you become a different individual altogether, a perfect person, happy, kind, generous, pleasant, always thinking of others, caring for others. You are a happy person when you are able to feel for others, love others. You do not think of yourself only, you think of others. More than that, you think of yourself. That is what is necessary. And that is the purpose of meditation. Meditation on your perfect representation. A representation, yourself, perfect according to you. That is what is meditation. Thank you.